Do you have trouble falling asleep, staying asleep, or just sometimes wake up in the morning already feeling exhausted? Turns out there's a lot of things your sleep can reveal about your health and things you can do to make your sleep better. First up, let's start with the brain. What's actually happening in our heads when our body slides beneath the sheets?
Although you're resting, there's a lot of activity going on. For instance, while you sleep, some of the byproducts that are produced as the day goes on from our activities and from our thinking can actually accumulate in our brain. So during sleep, that's when you take out the trash from the brain, those byproducts. So it's important to get enough sleep so that you can clear it out of your brain.
Your brain also transfers the important stuff into your long-term memory while discarding the rest. Then there's what's going on throughout your body.
The other thing that can happen is you have production of growth hormone. Not only does it help with your recovery, but it also improves your accuracy, your speed, and your concentration. The other thing is that sleep can affect your immune system. While you sleep, you have secretion of certain cells called cytokines, and those are disease-fighting cells, so even more reason to get your sleep.
When it comes to daylight savings time, how can falling back or springing ahead affect our sleep?
People take advantage of that extra hour of sleep during daylight savings time, but they don't make up for it on the other end. Or when you lose an hour of sleep, nobody adds that extra hour to their sleep time. So you end up being sleep deprived. And remember, if you lose an hour of sleep night after night after night, in 30 days, that's 30 hours of sleep that you've lost. You can never make that up. Plus, during daylight savings time, we've seen that there's an increased risk of heart issues, and studies have shown that there are increased motor vehicle accidents, so that's some of the manifestation of sleep deprivation.
So if you're someone who's having trouble getting those recommended 6 to 9 hours of sleep a night, other potential health problems could occur over time, such as high blood pressure, diabetes, or depression. Lack of sleep can also affect your memory and concentration skills. You may find info just isn't at the tip of your fingers like it used to be. And then there's caffeine. A lot of us reach for that cup of coffee during the day to keep us awake, but over time, that can cause a bigger problem.
Sure, it has antioxidants, which can be good for you, but it's a stimulant, so it can keep you up or wake you up at night. For some people, it can raise their blood pressure, their heart rate, or increase the risk of anxiety. And you're already vulnerable when you're sleep deprived, so you have to be really careful.
It's estimated that 1 in 3 adults are not getting enough proper sleep each night, outside of work, or just not having enough hours in the day sometimes. What is preventing us from getting quality shut-eye?
Sleep is controlled by 3 main things. 1 is your circadian rhythm. That's your internal clock. It likes consistency. So make sure to keep your bedtimes consistent, and that even means on your days off. A lot of times people will sleep in on the weekends or take a long nap, but that can actually cause Sunday night insomnia. Your brain is confused when you've gone to bed at different times. 2 is your homeostatic sleep drive, the drive to sleep. In other words, the more awake you are during the day, the more energy you expend, the more sleepy you get at night. So it's really important to get activity during the day. Studies have shown that getting activity early in the morning actually helps you sleep better at night. You also want to get sunlight because that helps keep your circadian rhythm in sync. And avoid taking long naps because when you take a long nap, you've taken away from the drive to sleep at night. And the third thing is conditioning. You want to condition the bed to be a place of sleep. Not where you read, not where you watch TV, not where you are on your phone. Not only do you get sucked in watching shows or scrolling through social media or looking at one more email, but the blue wavelengths that's from the screens can actually prevent our natural melatonin from being secreted, and that's going to affect our ability to sleep. So it's important, only sleeping in the bed or sex, and only sleeping in the bed, meaning not on the sofa, not napping or dozing anywhere else. And another bonus is take your phone and get it outside of the bedroom. Because if you don't have your phone right beside you, you're not gonna reach for it when you wake up. It allows you to have a nice, relaxing start to your day.
Okay, fine, no phone on the nightstand. Got it. But what if I do all of those things and I'm still having real trouble falling asleep? What's going on?
If you're doing all the right things, but you're still having trouble falling or staying asleep, then you could have insomnia. And that's something we've all experienced. Even I've experienced it. The issue is you don't want it to happen night after night after night, where it perpetuates itself. So there are two categories for insomnia. There's acute, when it's less than 3 months, and chronic, when it's over 3 months. And that can be a problem, particularly when it starts to affect your thinking, your functioning, or your mood. And that's when it's time to seek help.
There are at least 13 clinically defined kinds of insomnia conditions. Most are rare disorders, but there are a few that are most common.
The three most common types of insomnia I see are drug-induced insomnia, adjustment insomnia, and psychophysiological insomnia. Now, when it comes to drug-induced insomnia, the two most common drugs that I see affecting your sleep or causing insomnia would be caffeine and alcohol. Caffeine really should have a cutoff time of about 2 p.m., depending on how sensitive you are. You know, it can take up to 10 hours for it to leave your bloodstream. The other thing is you have to watch out for hidden sources of caffeine, like chocolate, or workout supplements, or even those fancy waters can have caffeine these days. And then the other culprit is alcohol. While alcohol might help you fall asleep, it can actually wake you up as it's being metabolized. The other thing is it's a diuretic, so it can wake you up to use the bathroom. Another type of insomnia that does not include something you ingest is adjustment insomnia. And that's when you have a change in your life that can affect your ability to fall or stay asleep. It doesn't have to be something bad, like a death in the family or a breakup. It can actually even be something good, like a marriage or going on vacation. These things can affect your sleep patterns. Most of the time, you go right back into your pattern. But if it starts affecting your sleep more than 3 months, you start having chronic insomnia, and that can be a problem. So it's really important to check yourself when you have changes in your life and make sure you get back to your routine quickly. Now, if something has been a problem and it's affecting your sleep to the point where it's making you anxious or depressed, or there are other factors, then you should be sure to seek help. The third type of insomnia that I see is psychophysiological insomnia. You start to stress out about whether or not you're gonna have insomnia tonight. And now the thoughts start racing. You think about what you should do tonight, whether it's gonna happen tonight, and it creates another problem. So if you notice this starting to happen, it's important to seek professional help.
So the good news is there are things you can do to help treat your insomnia, no matter the cause.
Everybody's sleep issue is their own. So it's important to treat each case individually, and that requires specific treatment for different people. When you see a sleep specialist, we go through a long list of questions to learn about your behaviors and your thoughts and your patterns.
But when it comes to treatments, sleep specialists like Dr. Hamilton can figure out what may work best for you. Treatments can range from therapy to different medications to other tools like meditation, which can help lower your anxiety while also improving your sleep. Now, if you have no problem falling asleep, but find yourself waking up in the morning feeling lethargic or just not well rested, or you're often tired, run down, or just plain out of it during the day, there could be physical reasons in your body that are preventing you from getting a proper sleep.
Everyone has had someone in their family or a friend who they slept next to and woken them up in the middle of the night from loud noises, snoring, maybe even gasps for air. Now, when you're awake, your throat is open, you have good muscle tone, and that lets your airflow well. When you're asleep, your muscle tone relaxes, and that causes the muscles to collapse and can cause blockage of the airflow, which could cause gasping or choking or snorting at night. That's what we call sleep apnea. When we measure sleep apnea, we measure how many times you have blockage per hour. Mild sleep apnea is as often as 5 times an hour, and it can go up to 30 times or more, which is what we call severe sleep apnea. Now, if you have sleep apnea that's severe, you obviously need to see a doctor to talk about what kind of options there are. Now, the options can be as simple as medications or surgery or possibly the sleep mask, what we call a CPAP. That gives a little positive pressure to your mouth to puff open the airflow in the muscles so that their tone stays up and you're able to get air at night. It is absolutely possible to have sleep apnea without having those gasping, choking episodes. So you may feel groggy, you may feel lethargic, you may just feel like you just didn't get a good quality night's sleep. And if you feel like that's a consistent part of your sleep, it's a good idea to see a sleep specialist.
Got it. But if you're someone who occasionally snores, does that mean you also have sleep apnea?
Now, snoring on its own is very common. And on its own, we don't get too concerned about it. However, if you're snoring consistently, if you're snoring so consistently that your partner is nudging you, or you're waking someone up or yourself up, then we worry that snoring is progressing to sleep disorder breathing or even sleep apnea. Sometimes occasional or consistent snoring can be caused by physical issues. So we think about physical blockage, which could be a large tongue, large tonsils, or small mouth, or deviated septum. And this physical blockage blocks part of the airflow, which causes vibration and snoring. Snoring can also be affected by the way you sleep. So when you sleep on your back, your tongue flops backwards. That causes vibration, which causes snoring. If you're sleeping on your side, your tongue may not flop back as much, and that might cause less snoring.
All right, so if you or your partner snores every now and then, what can you do to try and stop it?
There are definitely things you can do at home before you're going to a doctor. So if your nasal airway is too narrow, then we do have nasal strips that you can get over the counter that you can place on your nose to make your nose a little bit more wide up front and get better airflow. If you have nasal congestion in general, it's great to use a little nasal moisturizing spray, some saline spray, and that will help clear out some congestion. You can also use a humidifier at night or antihistamines if you're feeling very congested. If you have a physical blockage, so we're thinking about the tongue more, you actually can go to the pharmacy and there are over-the-counter bite blocks or mouth guards that can help bring your tongue a little bit forward by bringing your jaw a little bit forward. That opens the passageway at the back of your tongue so that you can breathe better. If you're a back sleeper, then it's pretty obvious. You need to stop sleeping on your back. So a couple things you can do for that. One is you can put a pillow behind your back, which will keep you from sleeping directly on your back. A more advanced way of doing it is take a fanny pack and put a few tennis balls at the back, and that way when you're sleeping, you won't be able to sleep on your back directly because the tennis balls will be in the way, and that'll keep you on your side.
Speaking of sleep positions, specific ones can also help you with your individual health needs. Dr. Hamilton, break this down.
When you're pregnant, especially in the second and third trimester, the best position to sleep in is on your left side. That can actually improve circulation. If you have acid reflux, the best position to sleep in is either on your sides, or if you prefer sleeping on your back, then try to keep yourself propped up. Having a wedge pillow can help raise you without bending you at the neck, and this can help prevent the contents of your stomach from coming up your esophagus. And finally, if you have back pain or any kind of spinal issues, sleeping on your back can be more comfortable. It helps keep your spine aligned. You may want to try a small pillow or rolled up towel under the knees just to keep pressure off your lower back.
What other things can you do at home before bed to help you get a better night's sleep?
Well, first of all, one of the things I always like to recommend is having a bedtime ritual. And you can start that by setting an alarm about 30 minutes before bed. When that alarm goes off, turn off all the electronics, dim the lights, light a candle, have some mood music, set the stage for good sleep. If you're looking for something to sip on before bed, you can try tart cherry juice, which has tryptophan and some of the elements that can increase melatonin. You could also try something like a turmeric latte. For some people, dairy can be a little upsetting to the stomach at night, so you can use oat milk or almond milk. Add a little bit of turmeric, which has anti-inflammatory properties, and a little bit of honey. Sometimes it's not even what you drink, but it's the act of drinking something every night that can be a nice, calming, and relaxing bedtime ritual. As it gets closer to bedtime, you might want to have a snack. And if you do need a snack, avoid the spicy, greasy foods because that can cause acid reflux or indigestion. You may want to try something like edamame or pistachios in the shell. They contain melatonin, and having food in the shell slows down the amount you eat. You also want to avoid sugary foods because those can cause a sugar rush, and then you can have a crash that leaves you feeling lethargic the next day.
Okay, here is the burning question. Can a glass of red wine help you fall asleep?
I know a glass of wine can be relaxing, but remember, although it helps you fall asleep, it can actually wake you up as it metabolizes. The other thing is, it's a diuretic, so you may wake up to urine more, or you may be dehydrated, and it can relax the muscles in your airway, causing you to snore, or even worse, cause sleep apnea. So remember, the best time to have a drink? Do it at happy hour.